The next section of SE Linux Policy Administration, the basics. SE Linux is a labeling system. So, labeling is important to SE Linux. SE Linux uses security labels to associate security metadata to subjects and objects or processes and system resources. So, in other words, is SE Linux labels subjects and objects with security context. So, a security label is basically a security context, and that's basically security metadata. Access decisions are computed using security contexts. So, with that in mind, you can probably imagine that it's important that those labels are correct, because if the security metadata is not correct, then incorrect access decisions are computed, and basically shit hits the fan. So you need to ensure that labels are correct. Always remember that SE Linux is, or labeling is the most important aspect of SE Linux, and so when troubleshooting, always first check that the labels are correct. So let's dig a little bit deeper into those security labels or those security contexts. So a security context is a label with security metadata assigned to subjects and objects by SE Linux. Labels with security metadata associated to subjects and objects by SE Linux are called security contexts. Okay, that's basically what I'm saying. So, security contexts are strings with security attributes delimited by colons. Each security attribute associates to one or more security models. So we just discussed security models, and each security attribute associates to one or more of them. So let's have a look at that. So lslz file, or actually let's just lsc file. So this basically shows us the security attributes of the file that we created earlier. It shows us the traditional Linux security attributes, which are the user identity, group identity, and the permission bits, as well as the SE Linux security attributes, which is the security context, which is delimited by colons, and each string, or each field, better yet, represents a SE Linux security attribute, which associates to one or more security models. But the fields are actually filled in with the with the security identifiers. So the fields are security attributes, but what you see, what they are filled in with, are the identifiers, which are specified by us. Just like the identities, group identity, user identity, are security attributes, but they are filled in with the identifiers, Dominic in this case. So that makes the Dominic a user ID and a group ID, because they are filled into the group ID and user ID security attributes. The same goes for SE Linux, basically. So we have a security context delimited by colons, and each field represents a security attribute that is associated to one or more security models. What you actually see in those fields, or those security attributes, are actually filled in with security identifiers, which are created by us and associated by us. So security contexts have a minimum of 3 security attributes and a maximum of 4 security attributes. So how does that relate? So I just told you in the previous section that there are three mandatory security three default security models and three optional security models, and that the multi-level security model and the multi-category security model both both are optional and mutually exclusive, and they both use what's called a security level security attribute. And that's basically the fourth field in a security context tuple, the security level security attribute. So it's, and that's basically used by the optional additional MLS and MCS security models. So if you don't have those two and either of those two security models enabled, then you won't see the fourth field, because you don't need it, because that fourth field is the fourth security attribute is used by MLS and MCS only. So that's why I'm saying that there's a minimum of three security attributes and a maximum of four. If you don't use MLS or MCS, then you won't see the last one, because it's not needed. The first three are used by the basic security models, and so they're always there. And there is the optional user-based access control security model uses the identity security attribute together with IBAC. Identity-based access control uses the identity security attribute, and the user-based access control security model, optional security security model, also uses the identity attribute. So the first three are always there, and the first field basically associates to identity-based access control and optionally user-based access control, and is filled in with the identity security identifier. The second field is the role security attribute field, and associates to the role-based access control security model, which is a default security model, and is filled in with the object underscore R identifier in this case, because we're dealing with a file. So role-based access control, the goal of role-based access control is basically to associate one or more type security identifiers to users. So basically that means that roles on files on objects don't really make sense, because that's just not part of the goal of role-based access control. It's a way to basically associate one or more type security identifiers to users, and users are processes, not files. So it does make sense to have a role on a file, a role identifier or a role security attribute on a file. So that's why the object R role was object underscore R role identifier was created. It's just basically a string and an identifier that is used as a placeholder for the role field in a security context for file associated to files. But anyways, so the role is used to the role security identifier associates to the role based access control security model. And the third field is a type security identifier filled in with the type security attribute, filled in with a type security identifier, which can be created and associated by us, and the type security attribute associates to the type enforcement security model, which is a basic security model. So you have this string of different security attributes that associate to different security models that deal with different challenges that we need to address to accomplish our security. So security attributes enable us to assign security identifiers to subjects and objects. So that's basically what I'm saying. So these fields are security attributes, and the security attributes can be filled in with security identifiers, which are created by us and assigned by us to those security attributes. Okay. So let's have, I'm basically getting ahead of ourselves. So let's have a look a little bit deeper into the security context. So yeah, you have the string here, which basically here it says identity, colon, role, colon, type, colon, security level. So if you translate that to an actual security context, which here, you have here the identity of unconfined underscore u, the role of object r, and the type of user underscore home underscore t, and then the security level of S0, sensitivity 0, the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy of sensitivities. So the first security attribute in the security context is a identity security attribute and associates to the IBAC security model, and optionally the user-based access controls, the optional optional UBAC security model. The identity security attribute can be used to assign identity security identifiers to files and processes, or to files and system resources, processes and system resources, blah blah blah. So the second field is the role field, in this case the object R. And the second security attribute in a security context is a role security attribute and associates to the role-based access control security model. The role security attribute can be used to assign role security identifiers to processes and system resources. Due to the challenge that role-based access control addresses, the role security attribute, the role security identifiers are only used for subjects. So that's why I'm saying what I said before. Since role-based access control is used to basically associate one or more type security identifiers to users, and since users are processes, don't actually use the role on files or on objects, because you only use them on processes, on users. So that's why the role security attribute in security context for objects is filled in with the object R object underscore R role security identifier, which functions as a placeholder, because we don't use the role on files, we just fill it in with the object R identifier, security role security identifier, just to fill in that space, because it's always there and we need to fill it in with something. So that's why we use object R to indicate that this is a file, a role for a file or for object generally. The third field in a security context tuple is a type. So the third security attribute is a type. The third security attribute in a security context is a type security attribute and associates to the type enforcement security model. The type security attribute can be used to assign or associate type security identifiers to processes and system resources. So here we have the type of user home T, which is a type defined by the administrator, by the security administrator, and it's used to associate to this file here. And the type security attribute associates to type enforcement, and type enforcement allows us to enforce integrity. So yeah, this identifier is used to enforce integrity. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about security level security attribute, the fourth. So it's optional. The optional fourth security attribute in a security context is a security level security attribute and associates to the MLS and MCS security models, which are both optional security models, additional optional security models. The security level security attribute can be used to assign sensitivities and category identifiers and ranges thereof to processes and system resources. So this single security attribute can be used to actually associate two kinds of security identifiers to processes and system resources. The sensitivity security identifiers as well as category security identifiers. So that's a little bit different than the other security attributes where you just assign a single security identifier. This security attribute is actually used to allows us to assign two different security identifiers. So a single security attribute used to assign two kinds of security identifiers. So can be used to sensitivity and category identifiers. Yeah, that's what we said. Due to the challenge that the multi-category access control model addresses, sensitivity security identifiers are not used with the MCS security model. So, just like the object, just like the role field isn't actually used for files because it's used to associate type security identifiers to users, to processes, the sensitivity or the security identifier isn't actually used when you enforce multi-category security, because the sensitivity security identifier is used to enforce confidentiality. But since both the sensitivity identifier and the category identifier both share the same security attribute, the security level security attribute, they are the security of the sensitivity identifier is filled in with something, with a placeholder, just like the role for files or for objects is filled in with the object R, just filled in because it's there. But it isn't actually used. So basically, when you enforce need to know with multi-category security, you only use compartments and not sensitivities. And this, the S0 is a sensitivity. That's why it's an S. It signifies sensitivity 0, which is basically the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy. And this is specified to this file in this case because this system enforces need to know, and so it just fills in the sensitivity with S0 because there's only one sensitivity with multi-category security and it's unused, so it just fills it in. But there's no categories assigned to this file. That's because well, the file is not compartmentalized, so to speak. So there's no compartment assigned to this file in this case. So the sensitivity security attribute is in security context on systems with the MCS security model enabled, is filled in with the S0 sensitivity security identifier, which functions as a placeholder. So that's what I'm saying. So here you have the S0 sensitivity that is the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy of sensitivities, but MCS only has one sensitivity, which is S0, and that's just filled in as a placeholder. So the security level security attribute is also delimited by a colon, but the combination of a sensitivity security identifier and a category security identifier or ranges thereof are a single security attribute. So that's what I was saying. So let's just look at another security context for a process, for my process. Oops. So IDC basically returns the current security context for the current process. So here we have a security context of my process, shell process. And it's basically filled in with the unconfined underscore used identity security identifier, the unconfined underscore R role security identifier, the unconfined underscore T type security identifier, and then we have this fourth field, which is actually one security attribute called the security level security attribute, but it's actually also delimited by a colon. So the sensitivity security identifiers are basically separated from the category security identifiers, but it's still considered a single security attribute. So we're basically assigning two kinds of security identifiers to a single security attribute, whereas with the other security attributes, we're just assigning a single identifier to a single security attribute. So that's a tad different. But anyways, since this is an MCS system, a system that enforces need to know for specified processes, the sensitivity is set to S0, the range S0, low and high are both S0, which is the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy of sensitivities. And then there's a range of categories associated to this process, which is basically the full range in this case, the full range available of categories. Category 0, which is basically the lowest category, or the first category, and category 1023, which is basically the last category. So there's 1024 categories available, and this process has access to them all. And this file has no category associated to it at all. So basically every process can, from a multi-categories perspective, access this file because it's not compartmentalized using a category. And this process can basically access all categories since it has access to all categories. So basically this for this process, is basically as full need to know access, so to speak, can access all every compartment. So that's just something to keep in mind. It's a little bit inconsistent that although this is a single security attribute, it's still delimited by a colon. So some smartass would say, okay, you say that the security context is delimited by colons and each field in there represents a security attribute, and then you say that a security context has maximum of 4 fields, but if I look at this, then the security context has 5 fields, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that's because this is actually a single field, a single security attribute, but it's a single security attribute that's also delimited using the same delimiter, but it's actually one field. So that's something to get used to a little bit. So and I'll show you the graph later, and then it's probably more visualized. So anyways, let's just deal with this chapter section first and before we get into anything later. So as Linux is labeling system, how subjects and objects are labeled, how processes and system resources are labeled. So there are basically globally 4 ways that how processes and files are labeled. So the first way is using the SLinux policy language, which we'll discuss in the next chapter. So SLinux policy language provides us with rules that enables us to instruct SLinux how to label a process or a file. So without going too deep into it, we can basically use rules to tell SLinux how to label a file. I will get into that later. Or a process. The second way is security context specifications. Basically, there's a list of location and security context combinations that specify system-wide how locations should be labeled. So that's basically a failover mechanism. It's a list, and I can probably show you, but I'll probably not. It says we manage contexts. No, cannot access that. I don't have permissions. I can go to root and show you that, but It's not needed. So basically, there's a list and with locations. For example, location foo. And then it can be used. Regular expressions can be used to specify that location foo and everything inside there should be labeled with, for example, context system u identity identifier object r because it's a file. Role identity identifier, role identifier, and the type my or foo t. I guess I get foo file t, and then the security level security attribute, which set to sensitivity 0, the lowest sensitivity in the hierarchy, basically a placeholder, just like optic r is just basically a placeholder. So these two fields in this case are just basically placeholder, this one and this one. But that's basically it. So as Linux basically queries the list with all these associate with all these combinations and says, okay, so it's specified here that slash foo and everything below it should be labeled with this context. And then basically library functions in a way are used to actually commit that. So you can basically there's a program that uses a library function that basically resets context, that can be used to reset context to what is specified system wide. So that program basically looks at the list and says, okay, so this is specified, let's reset it to what's specified by default. And then policy can be used to govern whether the program is actually allowed to do that. But anyway, so that's the second one is the SELinux context specifications. Object context specifications, I guess. And the third are library functions. So SELinux library provides functions that enable applications to create subjects and objects with specified labels. That's true, but they also provide functions to change the labels, to create and change the labels. So library functions, and those library functions can be used in programs. So, and then there's the fourth way, initial security identifier. So that's a special kind of way to label processes and files. Security identifiers are hard-coded, or initial security identifiers are hard-coded security identifiers used by SELinux for system initialization, predefined system resources, and fail-safe. So generally, system security identifiers can be created by us and associated by us. But initial security identifiers are instead hard-coded. They are inside Linux, SELinux in the kernel. They're hard-coded, and SELinux uses that to basically label stuff that is either used for initialization, or either predefined, or either for fail-safe. And we'll get into that in a little bit detail later. But with regard to system initialization, I can already explain that. For example, so policy is loaded by the by init. But before init runs, the kernel runs. The kernel threads run. So we need a way to basically label the kernel threads with security labels before the policy is loaded. And the policy specifies the context, the security context, and the security identifier. So you can't actually use a security identifier before the policy is loaded, because if the policy isn't loaded, then there's no security identifiers to use. So how do you label the kernel threads if the policy is not loaded yet? You'll use initial security identifiers, which are hard-coded into SELinux in the kernel, so that SELinux can use that before the policy is actually loaded to label the kernel threads. So that's what we mean with how these hard-coded security identifiers are used to are used for system initialization. And we'll get a little bit deeper into initial security identifiers in the next slide, I guess. Yeah. There we basically explain a couple more initial security identifiers, which are pretty common, which you're likely to encounter as a policy administrator. And we'll also explain why that is and how you can deal with them. So initial security identifiers, abbreviated ISITs, are a set of hard-coded security identifiers built into SE Linux. Yep, we know that. And let's explain some of the commonly encountered initial security identifiers. So the unlabeled initial security identifier, unlabeled _T, is assigned by SE Linux to processes and system resources that have one or more invalid security identifier. So this happens when, for example, you have a process that runs with a combination of security identifiers, and you basically reload a modified policy that no longer has one of those three security identifiers on a running system. So you basically do SE module install, and you install a policy module, a new version that removes some of the type of some of the security identifiers that you actually use in a running process. Then SE Linux kicks in because it notices, hey, this process is labeled with an identifier that doesn't exist in the policy. And then basically SE Linux kicks in and labels that process or that file with the unlabeled T initial security type security identifier, just to signal to us that, hey, this process or system resource is labeled with an identifier that's unknown to me, that's not available. So you need to basically determine which identifier that is and use one of the four ways to label to correct that problem. And the second, this can happen when you load a policy that does not declare one or more security identifiers currently used to label a process or a system resource. That's what I said. So if you see unlabeled T, then it's red alert, alarm, fix it, because there's one or more security identifiers used in that security label that is not valid. Okay, so the second common initial security identifier, type security identifier, is the file _T type security identifier, and this is assigned by SE Linux to objects that have no security context at all. So unlike the unlabeled T that is used to label processes or files that have an invalid security identifier, file T is associated to files that have no security identifiers at all, security context at all. So this can happen if, for example, on a running system, you hook in USB disk and use fdisk to create a file system, partition the stuff, and then you mount that newly created file system under a specific location. At that point, there are no security contexts assigned to the objects on that file system. So you'll see file T because there's no security context. What you need to do then is use one of the four ways to do to label, to assign security context or and commit security context to the objects on the file system. So in practice, that's usually running restore.con or tcon commands to commit what's either defined system-wide or just manually specify the security identifiers to use for the objects. So those are the two common ones. Continue. And then we'll discuss the persistent storage of labels. So security labels can, or security context can be stored persistently if the file system supports extended attributes. The security is extended attribute, to be exact. But yeah, to be able to use that, you also need to usually enable the security extended attribute in the kernel on build time. So there's this option here, config ext4, for example, fs securities, and you need to set that to yes if you want to use the security extended attribute for ext4 file systems. So yeah, if and ext4 supports the security extended attribute, so you set that to yes and you use ext4, then as Linux uses the ext4 security extended attribute to store security context inside the security period as a Linux extended attribute name. And then you could basically verify that, for example, this is an ext4 file system mounted on my home/home. So you can basically use the get flutter, I think, or it's double T, and then file. Oh, and you need to specify the name security SE Linux, else it won't return. So here you can see that it's actually, so now I'm basically getting the file attributes of the security period SE Linux extended attribute name for the file, for the file file, and it returns it here. So this is basically stored persistently on this file system, because this file system supports extended attributes, security extended attributes. So yeah, if you have some exotic file systems or some new file systems that do not yet support the security extended attribute, then you are shit out of luck with regard to persistent storage of security labels. Or you might need to actually enable that in the kernel on build time by looking up these. You can basically, what you can do is you can basically grab, I guess, for FS security, or yeah, that will probably show them. Let's just grab IFS security boot config. Yeah, you have them. So for example, RiserFS supports the security extended attributes, and it's actually set to yes. So it's, so if you have a RiserFS file system, then SE Linux can use it. JFS the same. But there are, for example, F2FS doesn't have it, and TFS, for example, seems to not have it. So you probably are not advised to use those file systems for persistent storage of security context. But I think TFS actually does support it, and it has a different option, which sucks. TFS. Well, those are too many. I'm not sure. So anyways, but just goes to show that yeah, you can you can do persistent storage of labels, but you need to the file system need to support extended attributes, and kernel support for it must be enabled. And then really with regard to security extended attributes, so user extended attributes, that's not suffice. And that's basically the end of the slide. So let's just have a look at ls documents grab pdf. And that's test PDF, so I can just go. Oh, Dominic. Documents, test PDF. And here we have this slide, and doesn't fit on the screen, so I'll just maximize that. So here we have a graphical representation from of all the stuff that we basically described. So basically you should, is that possible? No, that's not possible. But basically you should just turn it 90 degrees, because if you can look at it as in a stack way, where on top of the stack you have the traditional Linux security, and that uses the user identity and group identity security attributes and identifiers. Then below there you have the identity-based access control as a Linux security model, which basically glues ASI Linux, which basically is everything below on this side of the stack, to the traditional Linux security. So it's actually the bridge between everything else. And it uses the identity security identifier or identity security attribute. And then basically this one, the identity-based access control security model, associates to the identity security attribute in a security context. So this above here is a security context, and the security context basically associates the processes and system resources. So that's basically all the way below here. So there's the line that you can follow here, the line so you can follow. And basically the security models that are red are optional. And this basically should be the user-based access control uses the same identity security attribute as identity-based access control to basically compartmentalize need to know based on identities. But basically it should be not straight down, it should be kind of like under here. So just to show you that it's another layer in the stack, so to speak. And basically the user-based access control uses the identity security identifier, which is associated to the identity security attribute in a security context, and the security context is associated to processes and files. Our security contexts are associated to processes and files and system resources. So anyway, the identity-based access control accesses bridge between traditional Linux security and role-based access control, which is a default security model because it's in black, and multi-level security, which is a optional security model, which is red, and multi-category security, which is also optional, which is red, and both are these two are mutually exclusive. And then there's the different identifiers that are used by these models, and we also create the association between the field in the security context. So the role-based access control role security identifier is filled into the role security attribute field in a, which is the second field in a security context. And the MLS and MCS identifiers are filled into the security level security attribute, which is red here also because it's optional. If you don't have these two security models enabled, then you won't see this fourth security attribute field. And then, so that's a bridge between those security models. But actually, role-based access control is a bridge again between type enforcement and identity-based access control. So that's basically associated to the third field in the security context tuple, and it's black, it's not optional, it's mandatory. So basically you put that all together, you have on top here you have a security context, below here you have kind of the stack, not quite the stack, it's not quite fully 100% consistently represented, because these three actually should be lower in the stack than type enforcement. These lines here should basically go from here to all the way here instead of here. Because these are basically higher up in the stack if you look at it that way. But anyway, so this is the graphical representation of the relation between the fields in the security context and the security models and the identifiers versus security attributes and security context versus processes and files, and versus traditional Linux security security attributes. So yeah, this is basically this ends the first part of as Linux policy administration, and there's a lot of material, a lot of theory here, but yeah, if you want to explain this stuff in a no-nonsense way, then you'll just have to deal with some of these prerequisites. It's just a fact, but you can't explain it all because it's all associated to each other, and you need to basically have a natural flow, go from one topic, flow into another topic. So I thought this would be a pretty good start for a introduction chapter. So yeah, that's it. So in the second chapter, we're going to discuss the SELinux policy language used to instruct SELinux